That saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now
good morning, King's House. How are we doing today? Man, it is so wonderful to be back here in the greatest country on planet Earth, the USA. I want to thank everybody for all your prayers while we were in Africa. To say that we had an amazing time would be the world's biggest understatement. And to see the school and to see the fulfillment of God's promises and to be able to play such a small role in seeing that accomplished, King's House, it was one of the most rewarding, exciting experiences of my life. And we'll have some more footage and some more videos to come. But if there was ever an opportunity for you to be proud of your church, let me tell you, like, this is that opportunity. So thank you so much for all those who gave, for all those who contributed. You are more of a blessing than you could ever imagine. Thank you for all those who prayed for us. We got in to the States on Friday, and we were actually one of the last international flights that made it into the USA. And I am so thankful for that. So, man, close call. But anyways, we're kicking off a new series today, and I'm praying that you're going to be blessed, and I'm praying that God is going to encourage you with this series. We're starting a new series called Hymns. And before we dive into this morning, I want to share a quick story. I grew up in a little town called Seminole, and growing up all over town, you would see this certain individual, and he would just walk everywhere, and he'd be carrying a sack of cans, and he never looked up. He always just had his head down, but he just walked, and you'd see him all over town. You'd see him out on country roads. You'd see him everywhere. My dad worked in the oil field, so he was always driving, and he saw this individual everywhere, and everyone told my dad, this guy is crazy. Don't mess with this guy. Don't interact with this guy. This guy's just drive on past. He's crazy. So for years, that's exactly what my dad did. He just drove past this guy and just assumed that what everyone said about him was true. Like, this guy's crazy. On one certain summer evening, there was a huge thunderstorm coming. You could see it in the distance. And there was lightning and there was thunder. And my dad's finishing up work that evening. And he's driving down this dirt road heading back home. And there's this individual walking. Well, there's not a house for miles. And my dad realizes, like, this dude's about to be in a pretty serious predicament. So my dad says, man, just, I'm going to give this guy a ride. So he pulls up next to the dude, and he rolls down his window, and he says, hey! And the guy never looked up. He just kept walking. My dad thought, like, what's up with this guy, man? He's as crazy as people said he is. This dude's crazy. So he pulls a little closer, and this time with a little more passion, he says, hey, man, it's about to rain. The dude just kept his head down and kept walking. And my dad's thinking, you got to be kidding me. Like, what is up with this guy? So bound and determined, my dad pulls his truck right up behind this guy. Inches from him, and he blares his horn. Boom! And the guy never flinches. He never budges. He just keeps his head down, and he just walks. And all of a sudden, my dad came to a realization. This guy's not reacting to me because this guy can't hear me. And all of a sudden, he realized, like, I've thought for years and years that this guy was crazy. And in actuality, the guy's just deaf. So my dad pulls up and gets his attention and points to the rain clouds. And he gets in the truck. And anyways, my dad takes him home. And that started a friendship between my dad and this individual. This individual's name is Stanley. So my dad would periodically just go in and check on Stanley. And Stanley lived with his mom. But his mom was extremely sick. She had been a prostitute in California, and she'd contracted syphilis, which is why Stanley was born deaf. But she was in the last days of her illness, and just a short period after my dad met Stanley, Stanley's mom passed away. So my dad just continued to check in on Stanley and start to develop a relationship with him. And it was December, it was around Christmas time. And I was in the truck with my dad, and we're going by, and we're just going to say hi to Stanley. And I'll never forget, we walked into Stanley's house, and Stanley had a Christmas tree up, and there was presents underneath the tree. And I remember being a little kid thinking, man, that's fantastic. Like, Stanley's going to have a good Christmas. I walked over by the tree, and the tag on the present said, "To Stan, from Stanley." And then another one of the tags said, "To Stanley, from Stan." And I remember me and my dad just kind of looking at each other, just the realization that he has nobody else on planet Earth. And so that December day, Stanley was officially adopted into the Hennen family. That was probably 25 years ago. Stanley has never missed a birthday party. He has never missed a Christmas or Thanksgiving. My parents have helped this guy get vehicles and houses and just helped him in tremendous ways. And I can't help but think that on that summer evening, somewhere there were some kids probably upset because their baseball game got rained out. Somewhere on that summer evening, there was a get-together that was, there was supposed to be a barbecue, and it got canceled, and somebody was upset that their plans got messed up. Somewhere there was other situations going on, but in Seminole, Oklahoma, there was a man named Stanley. And because of that storm, his life was eternally changed. And I think it's important in times like this to realize, as we are in the midst of a storm, that for every storm, there's a purpose. And if you look close enough, and if you continue to trust God and move forward, the further you go, you're going to begin to realize that more than just a purpose, every storm is going to have an incredible blessing attached to it. And I believe that's where we are as a church and where we are as a society. And we have to stand in faith and confidence today. There's a purpose for what we're going through. And at the end of all this, there's going to be some kind of blessing that maybe we couldn't predict today. Maybe it's difficult to see the big picture at the moment, but there's a blessing attached to this storm. And I have a heart full of hope and a heart full of confidence today. God is exactly who he says he is, and he's going to continue to do exactly what he says he's going to continue to do. And we can take confidence in that. We're starting this series called Hymns. There's a genre of music in America that's called a Negro spiritual. And the neat thing about a Negro spiritual is that you can play almost every Negro spiritual by only using the black keys. As bizarre as that sounds, let me play one for you, and let me see if you can recognize it. Only using the black keys on a Negro spiritual. Anybody recognize that? "Swing low, sweet chariots." The thing about a Negro spiritual is that the songs are built off of a pentatonic scale. The music that we play this morning is built off of a 7-note scale called a major diatonic scale. That is a compilation of whole steps and half steps, and those steps form into 6 different chords. And I'm sure you're bored by now listening to this music theory, but that's the music that we play. But a Negro spiritual isn't built off a 7-note chord. It's built off of a 5-note chord called a pentatonic scale. Here's another Negro spiritual based off of a pentatonic scale that you might recognize. I think everyone recognizes "Amazing Grace." And in 1779, an individual by the name of John Newton wrote "Amazing Grace." And I don't know how much you know about John Newton, but before his conversion, John Newton was a captain of a ship. And not just any old ship. John Newton was the captain of a slave ship. And after his conversion, he penned those amazing words: "Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. And no doubt, no different than any of us this morning, John Newton needed amazing grace. As he was, we all were, a wretch that is in need of a Savior. But here's something so interesting about Amazing Grace, the song, that if you go to the Library of Congress today and you look at the official documents of Amazing Grace, on the top it says Amazing Grace. It says words by John Newton, melody unknown. And I would just like to think today that as John Newton penned those amazing words, that he already had a melody in his mind that he had probably heard countless times before. From the belly of a ship where people were facing unbelievable atrocities and enduring unbelievable hardships. From the West African coast where people use this pentatonic scale, I believe that on more than one occasion, he heard from the bottom of that ship a melody and a song coming up from there. Oh, 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 oh. And when he wrote those words, he knew exactly the melody that he wanted to use. The crazy thing about it is, when they were in the belly of that ship facing all sorts of hardships and things that you or I can't even imagine, struggling to survive, struggling with sickness and disease, knowing that their life had forever changed, that things were never going to be the same, that they had no real future and no real hope, they continued to sing. They had no idea that that evil, cruel captain of the slave ship would one day have an encounter with the love of Jesus. They had no idea. They didn't know that. And they didn't know that God would take that same cruel captain and he would use him to be an abolitionist and lead the charge to see slavery abolished in England. And beyond that, they had no clue that God would take that evil, cruel captain and use him to write one of the world's most famous songs that's been sung in every country and in every continent around the globe. They had no idea in those moments. And I promise you, they couldn't picture in their minds, as they're going through all that pain and turmoil, they couldn't picture in their minds that God would one day use that very same melody as thousands and tens of thousands and hundreds of thousands of people flooded the altar to give their heart to Jesus. They had no idea that God would use that melody to cause and create such a huge impact on a global scale. And I know that we're in the midst of a storm, and I know that there's hardships, but I just believe with confidence today that God can take this hardship and this storm, and he can do unprecedented miracles with it. I don't know what all that looks like, and I don't know what all God has plans, but I know that if we continue to trust God, if we continue to depend on his amazing grace, that he will do great and extraordinary things. With this storm, it's no different than any other storm. God has a purpose for this storm, and in this storm, there is an incredible blessing waiting for each and every one of us on the other side of this storm. There's just a few points that I think it's important for us to take note of in this difficult time. Verse 3 of the song Amazing Grace says this: through many dangers, toils, and snares, I have already come. It's his grace that brought me safe this far, and it's his grace that's going to continue to lead me home. The same grace that brought you this far in your life is the exact same grace that's going to be with you tomorrow and the day after that and the day after that. This isn't our first storm. This isn't our first trial. This isn't our first hardship. The reason you're here today is God's amazing grace. Amen. And the reason you're going to be able to face tomorrow and the day after that is God's amazing grace. In 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 8, Paul finds himself in the middle of a storm, and he's wrestling with the hardships, and he's crying out to God, Lord, take me out of this storm, Lord. Lord, remove this thorn from my flesh. Verse 8 says, three times I pleaded with the Lord to take it away from me. But he said to me, my grace is sufficient for you. My power is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, I will boast all the more gladly about my weaknesses so that Christ's power may rest on me. That is why, for Christ's sake, I delight in weakness and insults and hardships and persecutions and difficulties. For when I am weak, then I am strong. God's grace is sufficient for us in this time. Each and every one of us, His grace is enough. His grace is sufficient. His grace is all that we need. And I think sometimes we have a really watered down version of what God's grace is. I think sometimes we think of grace as just God not punishing us when we should be punished, or God forgiving us. Those times in life when we don't really get what we deserve and we say, God, I'm so thankful for your grace. That is what grace is. But there's something so much more that God's grace is. It's not just God not punishing us. Grace is God's power at work in your life that is enabling you to accomplish things that you would never be able to accomplish on your own. If you're watching at home today and you're thinking, man, I can't do this. This is too much, Pastor Mark. I'm scared. I'm worried. All this craziness going on. I can't do this. The answer is correct. You can't do this. In your own strength and in your own ability, like, you're so right, you can't do it. But if you lean into God's grace, if you depend on God's grace, I have good news for you today. His grace is sufficient for us. Every day, every hour, every situation, His grace is more than enough for us. If we lean into God, if we trust God, if we keep our eyes on Jesus, His grace is sufficient for us. It's not about our power. It's not about our strength. It's about His power, His grace at work inside of our lives. I will rejoice in my weaknesses, because when I'm weak, then I know God can be strong. Verse 4 of the song Amazing Grace says this: when we've been there 10,000 years, bright shining as the sun, we've no less days to sing God's praise than when we first begun. 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 6 says it like this: so be truly glad. There is wonderful joy ahead, even though you must endure many trials for a little while. Key part of the verse right there. We have to endure many trials for a little while. It's not forever. It's not permanent. These are temporary trials, temporary storms that we're going through as a people and as a nation. These trials will show that your faith is genuine. It is being tested as fire tests and purifies gold, though your faith is far more precious than mere gold. So when your faith remains strong through many trials, it will bring much praise and glory and honor on the day when Jesus Christ is revealed to the whole earth. Church, I want to encourage you today to keep your eyes completely fixed on Jesus. These trials, these storms, these hardships are just for a little while. This world is not our home. We are pilgrims passing through. Our citizenship isn't of this earth. Our citizenship is of heaven. I'm encouraging you, keep your eyes fixed on Him. Keep your eyes fixed on eternal things. Lean into God. Trust Him in ways that you haven't trusted Him up to this point. I'm telling you, if you will do that, your faith will result in praise and glory and honor. When you stand before God, King's House, I'm encouraging you. I'm admonishing you this morning to be strong in these difficult times. Be courageous in these difficult times. Do not be afraid. The Word says that God has not given us a spirit of fear, but a spirit of love, a spirit of power, and a sound mind. His Word says that perfect love casts out all fear. I'm telling you this morning, you don't have to be afraid. You can trust in God. You can trust in His amazing grace. The same grace that has brought you this far is going to be the same grace that is there for you tomorrow and next week and next year. And we will look back on these times. It may not be tomorrow, it may not be next week, but we will look back on these times and we will see that there was a purpose to this storm, and we will see that there was an incredible blessing wrapped up in the hardship that we're going through today. God is still in control. He is still in control. He makes all things work for the good of those who love Him and are called according to His purpose. I just want to encourage you today, King's House. I just want to tell you today to be strong, to be brave. I want you to know that your church is standing with you, that your pastors are standing firm, standing on the Word of God. We're praying for you like we've never prayed for you. We're believing for you like we've never believed for you. I can say with confidence today that I am not afraid of what the future holds. I know who I have believed in, and He is faithful and able to guard all that I have entrusted to Him until the day of His returning. I've given God my entire life. He's more than able to hold it. I'm not afraid. I'm not concerned. And I'm asking that you wouldn't be either. These are difficult days, but these are going to be blessed days as we have an opportunity to refocus our hearts, to refocus our lives on what's most important, as we have an opportunity to keep our eyes fixed on Jesus, as the worldly things fade away from our lives, as we have an opportunity to refocus on those eternal things that God has really called us to. As I prayed this morning, I just kept being drawn to Psalms chapter 23, and I just want to read it to you this morning. It's such an amazing, encouraging chapter. I would try to quote it, but I would probably forget it halfway through, and that would be embarrassing. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, because you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup runs over. Surely goodness and mercy will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. King's House, will you bow your heads? Will you pray with me? Will you open your hearts? Will you open up your hands to receive a blessing from God? God, I thank you today. God, I'm asking you today that you would bless us. God, that you would keep us. God, that you would cause your face to shine upon us. God, that you would give us your peace. God, you know every situation of every person, everything that they're going through. Lord, the fear they're experiencing, the anxiety they're going through. And God, I'm just asking you right now, supernaturally, that you would walk into each and every living room, kitchen, bathroom, patio, wherever they're watching church this morning. God, I just ask right now, Holy Spirit, that you would just walk into that room. God, that you would bring perfect peace. God, that your love and your presence would just overtake that atmosphere. God, that you would remove every bit of fear. God, that you would remove every bit of anxiety. God, I thank you that you promised us, God, to never leave us, to never forsake us, God, not for 1 minute, God. So, Lord, today we are trusting you. We're trusting in your amazing grace, God. God, I thank you that your grace is sufficient for us, for everything that we face, for everything that we go through. God, I'm praying a special blessing upon each and every person in each and every family this morning. God, that you would move in a supernatural way in their lives. God, I thank you that there is a blessing in this storm, God. We thank you for your amazing grace today. In Jesus' name, everybody says, amen. God bless you so much, King's House. Thank you for tuning in this morning. Listen, we're going to be reaching out to you this week with further plans and further instructions. As we know what the heck's going on, we're going to be in communication with you. But in the meantime, I just want to encourage you, text somebody. Call somebody. If you're feeling brave, go and visit somebody. Let's do everything within our power to let other people know that we are standing beside them, with them, that we are loving them, encouraging them. I know that we're not able to be with each other this morning, but that doesn't change the fact that we're still the body of Christ, that we're still a family of believers, and we need each other now more than we've ever needed each other. I love you, King's House. Have an amazing day. God bless you.